All right, guys, welcome back. Going into the third hour here of Bounce Power Dark Side Week 2. Maybe that's how I'll say it. I don't know. Anyways, Adam.
We'll figure it out.
Go ahead.
All right. So we come back in on this dripping, slightly bloody blonde kid standing in front of a computer console with the Imperial sigil on it and a space for a password. And he's typing, and the lizard dog, I guess, where are the two of you? Are you standing kind of like behind him, or Theron and Belsa, where did the two of you end up at?
I'm still sat in the bed.
Okay.
I'll stand behind him then.
Yeah.
All right.
I'm going to pee on Theron's thing.
What? Yeah, yeah. You peed on Theron? What?
MP.
I heard pee, and I was just like, "Well, this is going real dark."
Yep, we were in the bed together.
After everything we did to the kid, we peed on him.
Yeah, the mood struck.
You guys are taking another facet of dark.
And then I got up, drenched in urine, and stood behind the kid like nothing happened.
Just
you started this when you shot a kid, JP. You caused the escalation.
No sense of escalation here. Just like from zero to punching kids in the face and peeing on each other. Welcome to the Empire, everybody. The dark side's got all the weird stuff. So,
next week we'll cut to the light side just sharing crumpets with one another and talking about how pretty the sun is.
So how about that rebellion? Oh, very good. Good rebellion. Yes, quite nice. Thank you.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, in Belsa's bondage dungeon. So you're there and you're behind the kid, and he's typing kind of nervously, and this like lizard dog, this massive thing, like comes up and puts its paws up on the desk, and he's like, no, not now, Fluffy, and like pushes him off the desk, like types some more, and you can see him shaking, and he's like mistyped a couple of times, and he turns to you, and he's like, I don't know, I can guess, and he like types another thing, and it gets like a flash of red, and you can see that you've got him on the ropes. He's very nervous. So
I get down sort of like in a squat and turn the chair he's in to face me.
Mm-hmm.
And say forget about this for a moment. You're too worked up. Tell me if you can about your father.
He nods and he's like, "What what do you want to know about him?"
Everything. What does he like? What doesn't he like? What is the moth about?
Okay. Why don't you make a persuade roll? Try to get on his good side now that you've thoroughly pummeled him. You want to try and let's try and persuade him. So let's see, charm. I think in this case,
All right.
You're trying to charm him. You're persuading him through being kind. So I'm gonna say this one. It's gonna be difficulty two. So two purple dice. But right. I'm gonna use a force point to upgrade it. So for your dice pool, put two and then put one for upgrade. On the right side.
Okay. This is charm, you said?
Yes.
All right.
Nice. Okay. So you managed to good cop him, and he nods and he says, "Well, I don't spend a lot of time with my father. He's a very busy man. Things on Terrace have been hard lately, and he's been hard at work trying to make deals that will secure our position on the planet. I mean the Empire on the planet. He's a good politician. The local trade guilds like him. And you can see him like hoping you'll ask something specific because he's not like you can tell this guy doesn't know his kid very well. Like they don't have a great relationship."
I nod and say, "It sounds like, even though he's not around, your father is trying his best for you, for the family. It sounds like other people like him. I want to like him. It's a shame that your meeting with my agent ended rather bloody, and I give him a little Kleenex for his nose. And it's like,
right.
And I'm like, I want to like you. And like
adding the blood.
I feel if we could just get to know each other, we could forget how this has gone so far and maybe try again. What do you say?
He kind of like nods with the tissue to his face. He's like, yes, I know Father was very excited to have you arrive, and he's been, well, he was going to prepare, but he was called away on business. I was hoping that I could make a good impression on you, but that woman, what a brute. I can't believe she struck me. I'm going to have to speak to my father about her.
And I gave him a little pat. I'm like, she can be a brute sometimes. You understand why she did it, but she can be a brute. And I'm like, don't worry. I'll strike her for you later. And give him like a little pat on the head.
Right.
And I'm,
yeah, yeah.
And I'm like, a friend. And everything froze.
Dude, that's Skype is like next level frozen today. It's actually crazy.
Yeah.
Rebel interference.
Anyway, sorry, where did we leave off?
Say that again.
Oh, well, after saying that I would be like,
I'll strike
later,
before you later. Yeah.
Yeah. I was like, basically I had asked him if, you know, cause we're friends and I do that for him cause we're friends now.
Right. Yeah.
Right. Aren't we friends?
Of course. Yeah, so he says, I just think that discipline is so important. I've been reading a lot about the Battle of Hoth and how discipline is why we won and the rebels lost. And I just think it's very important that people understand the chain of command.
And I'd be like,
sniffles.
And I'm like, oh, I couldn't agree more. Would you like to be there later when I discipline her?
And he looks at you, Belle, like, he's not sure. He's just looking for someone else's feelings or thoughts on this thing. Yeah, so he like glances over at you. What do you do?
I give him like a friendly smile.
Right.
That's it. Okay. Just like a warm smile.
He's like, no, I think it would be sufficient if you were just to reprimand her on your own. And I trust you, officer. He like nods, like, you'll do a good job.
I'm like, see, we're getting along famously. Can you tell me about this? And then I pull out the locket and show it to him and open it up. And there's like the little hollow thing.
He has a facial reaction. There's an emotion that he experiences. Whether or not you pick that up, I think is another matter.
Are we rolling perception?
Yeah, let's make a roll to see, because he responds emotionally and then takes a second to decide what he's gonna say.
Okay.
So yeah, I think perception is appropriate here.
Do you want us to both roll or just
one of you can roll and the other can assist. So whoever's got the highest pool, go ahead and roll.
Perception's
like halfway down.
Yeah, I have 3 green. So
I have 2 yellow.
Go for it, bro.
Okay. Right. So, why don't you roll? It's gonna be tricky. There's some buried stuff here. So, Belle, difficulty 3. So 3 purple dice and 1 blue die. And then
use that point, bro.
You gonna use a destiny point?
He just gave us one back. Use it.
Yeah, you know what? Use destiny points.
All right.
Okay.
So I just tap one on the upgrade.
Yeah. Put one in upgrade on the left on your side. It's an upgrade for you.
Okay. 1 blue, 3 difficulty, 1 on the upgrade.
Holy.
There you go. Wait. Look at that. Massive success. So
I thought you fucked up the roll because that was way too good.
Yeah, no, that's good. That's a good roll. So why is this so obvious to you, Belle? Like he's having an obvious, strong emotional response that I think to an average person might seem hard to pick out. Like there's like a twitch in one eye and like a bit of a scowl before it all happens very quickly, but you pick up on the whole thing. He's an open book. But why is that? Like what?
Well, obviously I think we revealed in the last episode that Belle does have some force powers. She's able to foresee what is and what will be, and she can like sense imbalances And so I think she kind of picks up on his reaction, even without seeing his face. And that brief pause kind of like gives her all the information she needs to know.
Cool. Okay. So there's a lot going on here emotionally. He feels showing him the locket is a reminder of, it's not the locket he's reacting to. It's a response to the relationship between his mother and father. And a reaction to being forced to, he's never seen the locket before. There's resentment there for both of them. There's sadness in seeing his mother. He obviously doesn't feel sad about his father. The resentment is that his mother like left him. Like he feels like she's gone and should be here. And then resentment that his father loves her, even dead, more than his father loves him alive. All that like flashes over his face in a second. And then he says, he looks at you, Theron, and he's like, I've never seen that before.
I didn't recognize the emotion. So I mean, would I believe him?
No, I mean, the two of you are doing this together. So you're both complicit in the, the moment. You both get that information. I think that you notice he's now, Belle, because you're not sitting next to him, you're standing away. He's like gripping the last sheet that's still on the bed, like gripping him in like both hands, and not in like a scared way, like he's angry. You can see like his knuckles are all like pale.
I kind of like, as this happens, I kind of just say Theron softly to Theron, just implying that something was wrong in that situation, because he didn't pick up on it.
All right. And so I put the locket back in my pocket and simply stand up and turn to walk away a little bit to give him a little space, and then turn back to him and point to his hands gripping the blanket so fiercely. And I just go, clearly it means something.
He shakes his head and he says, what I said was true. I've never seen the locket before. It looked to be something my mother owned. I suppose you found it in here. And he's immediately like, once you pointed out, he like lets go of the sheet, but he's still like trembling a little bit.
And I go and I sit back down on the bed, and like in a warm sort of way, I'm like, tell me about your mother.
He shakes his head. I never knew her. She died when I was little.
Do you know her name?
He nods. Her name was Thalassa.
It's a beautiful name. Perhaps even a better password?
He like glances over the computer. Belle, you're standing like closest to it, I think.
Yeah, so I kind of just swoop around the outer exterior of the room, like avoiding the conversation physically, and I just go over to the computer and type the name in.
Okay, yeah, done, no problem, that's the password. The kid looks at you, Theron, and sees that the password has like been entered. There's like a beep as the computer opens, and he looks at you like, wow, you're good at your job.
Theron just smiles and sort of stands the kid up and gives him a nice pat on the back, and he goes, sometimes doing a job can be fun. Sometimes it involves cleaning up a bloody-nosed youngling, and other times, well, hopefully it won't have to come to that. I can't wait to meet your father.
And he like, yeah, like sniffles and like, you know, wipes his nose again, like looks at the handkerchief and then looks at you like, do you want this back or?
I take it and I put it in my pocket with pride.
Okay, of course, all right. Of course. He, I think he like salutes you and then he leaves.
And as he leaves, I just lock the door behind him.
Okay.
And turn back to Belle, and I'm like, what have we found?
Cool. Okay. So the two of you hunch over the computer, and we diagonal wipe to, I think, like, dinner later. So Assistant Chamra has prepared a dinner for you. You've started going through the Moff's computer stuff, but it's not well organized. It's like digging through a person's computer and looking through all their emails. Like, most of it's boring, bureaucratic horseshit. It'll take you some time. You'll have to, like,
sorry,
you know,
I really Alex commit sells to with it. That shit. She's just chanting through it.
Yeah. So, I guess there probably wasn't a ton of time, but if you want to make a roll, we could see if you found anything particularly interesting before we go to the like dinner that they've prepared, or you can wait and you can all look at it over like more time. What do you want to do? Should I take a look at it before? Yeah. I mean, you'll have an opportunity to like sit down with it. Hopefully later. It's just a question.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. We might as well roll to see if we got anything straight away.
Okay.
What am I rolling?
It's not computers because it's not about like bypassing the records necessarily. Searching through records. Okay. Yeah. So it is a computer test. Perfect. There you go. Thanks, game. Cool. Okay. So yeah, just make a computers test. You have access, so it's I'm gonna say it's one purple die because the task is not difficult, but throw two black dice in there because there's just a sheer volume of like bureaucratic nonsense. Jesus.
All right.
There you go.
Okay. Oh wow.
So you get a success, but you take a strain because
it's just so boring.
Yeah. Totally.
It's so boring that it hurts me.
Yeah. It's and you can feel like, you know, that feeling when you're doing something boring that you have to do and you've been doing it long enough that you want to quit but you can't, and you sort of get angry about it. You're like, it's so boring. You start to feel that like start to stress you out. Yeah. But yeah, it looks like the moth has been mostly focused on like trade related stuff. Like he's using almost all of the security forces to protect himself and his allies in the various like guilds that control trade on Terrace. He's done next to nothing to root out the rebels. There's lots of like unanswered emails or like polite, terse kind of like, yes, I'm doing everything I can replies to any kind of like ask about like, well, so how are you doing on that rebel problem? But there is no evidence that you can find yet that he's really done anything. He seems to be focused on a different priority maybe than you are. But there's no clear evidence here that he's like in cahoots with the rebels.
Okay, but it's clear his priorities don't.
Yeah, he's not like
with the Empire.
I mean, maybe, right? Like the Moths are allowed to have a certain degree of authority as long as they're doing a good job. But inversely, you know, obviously you're here because he's not doing the job that, you know, the government wants him to be doing.
Okay.
Yeah. So I guess, have that information. Yeah.
I
guess I would have compiled a report and like given it to Theron.
I love that your job is to compile reports. It's like, I love it.
Yeah.
I made a report.
Does,
she did all the hard work and then passed on it to you. But yeah, do you share that with Lena and Otto? Do you have a conversation before dinner or?
Well, is everyone at this dinner?
Yeah, I mean you're guests of the Moff's house.
Okay.
Even if he's not here. So the assistant Chamra and Dade would have like put together a dinner for you as a formality. Okay. You're all invited.
Well, I guess I stopped shooting people at 17. I get up to 17 and just stop. Like I and then I like clean my. I like take almost a like a sacramental or what am I trying to say, like a proper cleaning of the gun after that.
Mm-hmm. Were they all kids? Did you kill them?
No, it was whatever Adam.
Okay.
Whoever was doing rebel shit.
Yeah, and I mean I'm sure at least one of those was like you saw like a mugging in progress and you were like, shoot the mugger or whatever. So someone
you
was
tried,
like, oh, I'm safe.
You tried so hard to make him. Kind of nice, kind of. I used to, maybe there was a mugging. I don't know. Maybe a mugging happened, and you no. Nope.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just saying. He's. I guess this is the question, right? Like, you're cleaning up, right? You want to like stop crimes.
Yeah, this right? is like, in Otto's mind. This is a proper way to get rid of violence.
I mean, yeah,
and
like
crime
on the,
and bullshit.
On the other hand, you probably shot someone for littering too. So it's like, I mean, whatever.
Oh yeah, there was any infraction that the Empire would deem bad, they got shot for. there's no like, oh, I'm just going to remove your arm. It's like, no, these are all headshots. Yeah. Shoot to kill.
Meanwhile, 161 and I are playing dice. Oh, there's another one. Did you hear it? I wonder what that one was. Like, we're just taking bets on what he's shooting.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I think, I mean, 161's all business, right? So when you're like, yeah, oh, that's another one for, that's another one. Who had dibs on 17? Like, there's a lot of like, you know, good observation, ma'am. And like, he's kind of grudgingly like, yep, nope, I can't really like play along. So I gotta be disciplined here.
You yeah. see me just like jokingly punch his shoulder and saying, loosen up, no one's out here.
So, yeah. So I think at the dinner, you're in the Moff's like great hall. And, this hallway is like it's like the centerpiece of the castle. There's a huge repulsor lift table with chairs around it. The surface of the table is like black marble. The floor is like white marble shot through with gold. There's huge columns, and then on either side there are these massive draperies, these massive red and gold draperies. And then at the back, behind the Moff's chair at the head of the table, is an enormous portrait, an enormous oil painting of him in his uniform, looking like stern with the Imperial logo behind him. And we pan down over that image to the kid, who's dressed up in like a junior, basically the like Hitler Youth of the Empire, like a junior Imperial officer's outfit with like a special like, you know, child brigade like badge on it. And he's got like, you know, his little cap. And he's sitting in his father's chair, which is like way too big for him. And there are droids like bringing out food and setting the table. The assistant Chamra is to his right. Theron, you're to his left, and then the rest of you are on either side of the table.
Am I even allowed at the table? The kid hates me.
Yeah, you're a guest of his father. And actually, I think, okay, so as you, like, as you're sitting, maybe, he gives you this smug look. Like, he's got a bandage over his nose now. And he gives you this smug look, like, oh, you're going to get yours.
Oh, but I still walk up, and I'm like, hey, kid, you know. Whoop. I can't, my brain just, like, completely wiped right there.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I sort of walk up, I give him a look, and I smile, and I say, hey, it's in the past, man. I was just doing my job. And I, like, just walk away.
He scowls and he looks at Theron and then looks back at you and he says, you would do well to address me as my lord, as is appropriate for my station.
And I look at her and look at him and say, well.
And I go, yes, my lord.
And yeah, and he like kind of puffs up a little at that and looks at Theron like, yes, good.
And then I walk away and I make sure, like, I just turn my face away and just roll my eyes and put my fingers in my eyes, like, oh my god, I just want to punch him again so bad. and if anyone can sense that, then they could just feel the anger rising.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. So Otto, you've been kind of away all afternoon, keeping busy. What's the table conversation like? How is everybody dressed? Do you dress like in your usual outfits, or is anybody dressed up for the dinner? Like, obviously the kid dressed up, so.
I mean, I think I'm just in my usual like leather studded outfit. I didn't dress up or anything. Like, this is still, even though we're having dinner, like, this is still work. Like, this is still a work thing, so.
I took off my armor because, you know, I wear armored clothing. And so I took off, like, the armor and I just got, like, you know, like a white shirt underneath and just some like, khaki rugged pants and boots. But I don't have, like, any of the armor on right now. So it's uncomfortable to sit in.
Yeah, I would say the slug thrower rifle was left at the door. It's like propped up against the entrance into the room. I don't have it like table side or anything.
Yeah, I mean you can give it to one of the stormtroopers. Like 161 doesn't let the four of you go anywhere without like a trooper escort. So there's a couple of stormtroopers here. 161 himself is out like on patrol, but yeah, you've got a couple of his men at the door.
That's who's holding then. They just have it like a British soldier holding a rifle just at the door.
Yeah, they're on guard.
And then in terms of like talking or conversation at the dinner, I don't really talk unless Theron asked me a question, or the kid asked me a question.
Mm-hmm.
You see me very properly eating, but I'm like kind of quickly eating and not listening or not really talking or responding to anything.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Okay.
So I would think that
Mel's hair's like done up. She's fixed up. She's got like table etiquette for days.
Yeah. Do you have like a complicated Lady Star Wars haircut now? Like, because all the women in Star Wars are like super weird, like updos. Yeah.
Buns, like four buns.
Yeah.
Four.
Damn. My hair's been wrapped up.
Four buns.
That's even more than Ray.
Damn.
Yeah, mine just braided back and that's it. And like, it's all like rugged and loose because I didn't bother like tidying it up at all. So I'm the opposite pretty much.
Oh yeah, no.
Like
You don't have any. You're bunless. You have zero buns.
I am
buns.
Bunless.
Yeah.
Zero buns. Not like fancy etiquette, and I don't look pretty. I still got some like sweat like marks from like the dirt that collected on my face from being outside, and like I just don't care.
Okay. She ain't no Leia.
Yeah, so I would think the only conversation is like the kid and Theron, and maybe the assistant.
And Belle, maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah. Assistant Chemra stays pretty quiet. He's pretty terrified of you. And that seems to make Dade happy. Like, Dade likes it when the assistant is, like, scared. And occasionally will, like, bait. He's trying to bait the assistant for you, Theron, where he'll, like, make some point about something. And they'll be like, oh, what do you think, Assistant Chemra? And Chemra's like, my lord, I'm sure I don't know. And, like, he keeps looking at you like, we can torture this guy. It's fun. I do it all the time.
I give him sort of a smile and acknowledge what he's doing and sort of like, oh, I totally approve. This is wonderful. But then I ask him about the actual planet itself and how he thinks things are going as current acting Moth, how he thinks things are going and what he would do if he was in charge.
Sure. Yeah, I think he says, there's been an awful lot of Republic activity, sympathizers on this planet, in the middle levels and coming up from the lower levels, and it's all the aliens, as I told you before. And if we just got rid of them, then things would go back to normal around here. People don't respect the Empire's authority because they have this alien influence on them, and, well, I think that's something that we need to fix. Now, I'm glad that you're here, and I assume it's to be start the process of cleaning up this alien infestation that the planet has. Don't we have some prison planet we can send them all to?
Theron laughs, and he's like, oh, I'm sure there's some. I know one, 241, I think it was. Oh, delightful place. We can send them all there. That's a callback last episode. Woo! So anyway, he sort of gives like a smile and then looks over at everyone else and then goes back to talking to him about is like just grilling him for information on where he thinks the aliens are, if they're all on the lower level or if they are if there's certain spots where they're at, places where he thinks these rebels would be.
Yeah, you get the impression he's never really, like, he doesn't leave the compound. He's not really allowed. It's unsafe outside the walls. And he doesn't, he states that as a fact, not as something that he's like rallying against. He's not like, oh, Dad never lets me leave the castle. He's like, no, it's scary out there. I stay here. But I've heard, the aliens come up from the lower city and, that's where those nasty aliens are at. You should go get them. But he doesn't really seem to know that much more. And it's obvious he's just saying things his father has said. Like he's just verbatim, like repeating things that his dad will certainly say to you again.
She, like, brings a fork up but doesn't eat the food yet, and she just sort of, like, looks over as they're talking about aliens and how big and bad and scary they are and how she just doesn't believe any of it. She doesn't believe that they could, that many could really be that bad. But, yeah.
Do you say anything?
No, she doesn't say anything yet. She kind of holds her tongue right now, but...
Mm-hmm.
So you could, if anyone noticed, then they could tell that she just sort of didn't believe the kid. So.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I just grill him, continue to friendly chat and see if we can get information But if he doesn't have any, then I'm not going to pry because he's a kid.
Have we been told when the... Or I guess at the end of the dinner, I'm just like... I turn to the kid and say, when will your father be back?
He says, I haven't spoken to my father in a few days, but when he left, he said that he would be back by the end of the week. That's 2 days from now, local time. You're welcome to make this place your home. If you need to leave the Citadel, let Assistant Chamra know, and we'll make sure you have the appropriate security. If you go into the city, it's a bit nasty, as I'm sure you saw on your way over.
I turned to... Go ahead.
Oh, no. I'd rather hear what you had to say first.
I turned to Theron and say, perhaps we should go and send some scouting groups out.
That sounds like a lovely idea. Where did your father go, if I may ask?
He says he's on a tour of some factories in the South Continent.
The South Continent. What ways are there to travel to the South Continent?
He says, my father has a small fleet of shuttles. You can use one of those if you'd like.
I just sort of nod, and I'm like, good to know. And then just continue eating and changing the subject to something entirely different.
Cool. Okay. So the kid, this from outside, the kid seems pretty like attached, I guess, to Theron. Like he's just doing a lot of like nodding and agreeing with things that Theron says. And when he says stuff, he does that thing where he'll say something to somebody, like to Otto or Belle, and then look at Theron to see how Theron reacts to what he said. Like he's trying to like curry his favor. But he doesn't have too much more to say than what you already know. He tells you that in his opinion, yeah, like, you know, aliens are ruining the planet. And that, you know, if we just get rid of them, then all the rebel stuff will go away and the planet will be fine. But obviously it's not a fully, worked out opinion about things.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right.
When dinner finishes, I pull Theron aside, or at least grab his ear at some point.
Sure. Yeah, can we have a meeting with everyone?
Okay, then maybe like dinner ends, and do you just say like everyone out? Like we just have our meeting here in this room.
I figured we'd all go
back to the Moff's room. Probably.
Yeah, we go back to the Moff's room, aka headquarters, okay. And have a talk there.
So Otto, you haven't seen the room before, so we see it from kind of from your perspective. It's like, yeah, weirdly empty, just like gray concrete walls, but there's these big discolored patches where art used to be on the walls. All the furniture aside from like the bed has been moved out of the room, and there's like an empty closet off to one side. Okay. For a Moff's quarters, it's pretty Spartan.
Gotcha. And that's how it was I walk into the room and say, was this room like this when you found it?
And I just give him a very big smile and say, I hear the guest quarters are lovely.
I kind of just like walk over to the painting and run my finger along where the painting would be on the edges.
Mm-hmm.
And then turn around and say, I think we should go and check out these factories tonight. Perhaps take the kid's father and leave him in charge of this planet. He seems to be in the Empire's favor.
I bring up the computer console and say, well, we found some wonderful information about dear old dad. Turns out he may not be in this for the Empire after all, but he's definitely in it for himself. Turn to Belle and I'm like, perhaps you can do a little more digging and see exactly what father's up to?
Belle just nods. I mean, like, what else can we decipher, Adam,
and
from this?
I'm like, it doesn't sound like he's interested in, or, sir, if I may speak, is what I say to Theron.
Lena?
And I say, we all know the rebels come in all races and sizes, and the kid only made mention of aliens. It doesn't sound to me like they're interested in rebels so much as just regular street scum.
Sounds.
I don't know about the trade thing, by the way. Like, I don't know that he's doing some trade, but based on what it sounds like to me, it sounds like he's dealing with people that are more into a trade that Lena might have a history with, and she's sort of like, I don't know if they're actually looking for rebels so much as they're looking for shady people. So.
Right. Yeah. So I sort of break everything down. And relay what we found out from the computer, what little we found.
Yeah.
And if I send Elsa to dig up more information, can we find more? We just ran out of...
Yes, like, that was just a cursory glance. Like, if you spend several hours digging through it, then yeah, you might be able to get some more.
All right. And so then I decide what we should do is tonight... Otto takes 3 stormtroopers and heads down in one of these ships to find the father and see where he's at in the southern continent. And Lena should go investigate the lower levels and see what she can find where these rebels are, because she's the least imperial out of all of us, and so she'd most likely fit in down there. And I will stay here with the sun. And talk to him some
more.
Have
a boss.
Yeah. Have him let him pee on me. And then
I take 161 with me if I can, with some like a couple extra troops. Or should I not take?
No, you should.
Yeah.
Yeah.
By myself?
It's more of an undercover thing.
Yeah, you're by yourself.
Oh, okay.
You don't even want to take stormtroopers with
you.
You definitely don't want a stormtrooper.
Okay. When you tell me to go to the factory, I say, do you want him alive?
No, strictly recon. I just want to know what he's up to.
Understood. And I just walk out of the room. Maybe I grab my gun. Or I guess the stormtrooper would have followed me with my weapon or something like that. So I take that stormtrooper and find 2 more. And then go find a shuttle.
I just go replace all my armor, grab my weapons, and then walk out. Walk out to go do what I'm supposed to do.
Okay. Yeah. So it's night. It's nighttime on Terrace. The sun is set, and the sort of sparkling of the city lights off of the smog layer is visible. And you can see somewhere in the distance, there's like a pillar of smoke rising from some fire. You can see it reflecting off the clouds, like off in the edge of the district. And I think that. Yeah, you head off in your direction. Let's start with let's start with Belle, with your role, to see what an evening of research turns up for you.
Okay.
I'm just man-moding
this console for hours. And
yeah, it's a computer role, and we'll make it the same difficulty as before. But since you're going to take your time, and you've got all night, throw a boost die on there as well.
So what was it? 1, 2 black.
Yeah, 2 black, 1 purple, and 1 blue, and then roll your computer roll. You can spend a destiny point. Oh, it's because it's still, you haven't reduced the amount of cruft, right? Like, it's still frustrating and difficult.
Okay.
It's boring.
Should I use a destiny
point? That's
why there's
more black dice then.
What do you guys think?
How many do we have? 3?
3.
Yeah, you got 3 right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, use it.
Yeah,
use it.
I got, it's important. Go ahead.
You're our evidence. We need it.
Yeah, it's true.
Right, fingers crossed. Nope.
Oh, ooh,
God damn.
The computer short circuits, and you electrocute and die.
Yeah.
Turns out Belsa never learned how to actually type, so she's just kind of like...
mashing.
Just doing that all night.
Did you know that I hit Alt F4 and it turns the thing off? It's amazing. I just learned that. I didn't even know that before today. It's just like, it's this slog of like dull reports and counter reports. And like, you spend 2 hours straight reading an argument between the Moth and someone who runs a factory that makes droid parts, where the droid part factory guy is like, I think that the tariff on droid parts should be 2%. And the Moth's like, no, it says right here in the code book it should be 6%. And he's like, but what if we change this regulation? And like, just that, just for hours, this pummeling array of dull garbage. Until you find, and again, unrelated, you're not going to get anything, you're looking for trader stuff. You do find a thread from fairly early on. It seems like his record is mostly clean, but there is some personal communication you find between this guy and between the moth and someone who, I don't know what his wife's last name is. Let's say her name is Turnell. It appears to be his wife's like father. So there's emails back and forth about her funeral, about making arrangements for her funeral. So this is like a, you know, 10-year-old communication. And they're talking about this. And the tone of the Moff's email communication, the tone of his messages here is totally different. Like he seems like a completely different person. He's like much softer, much less like aggressive, very conciliatory. And there's like emotive content in these messages where he's like, I just feel so helpless. I can't believe what happened. I miss her so much. Like kind of all this like back and forth. And you get a little bit, like they never directly discuss what happened to her, but it was unexpected. She didn't like get sick and die. Like something bad occurred. And he uses the phrase like, she was taken away from us. Stuff like that. Yeah. Right. So you find that thread.
Right.
Yeah. Cool. So while you're doing that, which of the side missions do we want to take a look at first? Do you want to do yours, Lena?
Yeah, so I'm like down in the underground or the bad part of the city, right?
It's just hey, we're back. Hey, hello.
Okay.
Hi.
I don't know what I said.
Nope, we're good.
No, so, we didn't hear like anything. A good 10-second freeze.
Yeah, that was the longest freeze yet. That was impressive.
That was a long one.
Yeah.
Well,
so
as I was saying, I'm down walking through the lower districts, the red light district or whatever.
So Terrace is divided into three levels. There's the upper city. There's the middle city and there's the lower city, and the upper and lower cities are fairly fairly static, right? Like the people that live there don't change too much. The upper city is where people that are like respectable members of Imperial society live, officers of the Navy, like anybody who's important lives there. The lower city is like the actual planet's surface, which is, you know, buried under thousands of feet of city on top of it, and that's where all the aliens kind of get to go. Like if you're an alien, you probably live down there. There's some mixing of aliens and humans in the middle city. The middle city is like if you can't afford to live in the upper city and you're a human, you kind of end up there. Or if you're an alien, you may end up in the middle city if you're particularly prosperous. And it's where all the kind of like organized crime stuff happens. Like this is where, you know, you have people who are like scamming aliens from the lower city, be like, yeah, no, like all you have to do is pay me 1,000 credits and you and your family can come live in the middle city. And they just never show up. And like, you know, it's a pretty scummy place, but there are still people who live there that aren't, you know, scum and villainy. So it's a complicated social strata.
Well, I'm guessing I'm in the middle or am I in the lower?
I mean, going to the lower city would be like,
it'd be dangerous because I'm a human.
Very risky to go alone. Yeah. Especially as a human.
So yeah, I'm probably in the middle right now. Sure. And like I said, as we froze, I have my mask up and all you can see is like a scar and then like my eyes, which, you know, one green, one blue. So you can see those, but you can't see like anything else. I'm like fully covered. I have my hair tucked in. Mm-hmm.
And I think as you walk up to the hyperlift, that'll take you down to, the middle city. There's a guard there. He's, you know, he's not a stormtrooper. He's just wearing like the gray kind of like Imperial Planetary Police Force like uniform. And he like, as you walk up, he like puts his hands up and he's like, ma'am, this is a tube to the lower city. He like, it's dangerous down there.
You mean middle city? Because I thought that was.
I mean, it goes all the way to the lower city.
Oh, okay.
He's just warning you, like, hey, it's dangerous. Like, where are you going?
And I just sort of like, like finger him out of the way, like it's fine.
You pew pewed him out of the, you just went
yeah
wow
yeah. Think about it though. I have a vibro sword. I have a blaster. I'm like fully geared out in armor. It's like I'm not someone that's just like, you know, totally. Like I can't handle this. I'm fully geared out and everything.
I think he didn't notice that at first, and then he's like, he sees me. He's like, takes a step aside, and he shakes his head. He's like, "It's your funeral, or theirs, I guess." He laughs.
Yeah, and I sort of laugh as well, yeah. And just walk past.
Yeah, he's like, "Have a good time."
And as I like as I like get into the lift, I turn around and I say, "Oh, I intend to," and then just the doors.
Yeah. Close up. Okay. Cool. So yeah, the doors shut, and you find yourself in the middle city. It's cramped. It's hot and humid. There are buildings on top of buildings. The ceiling, you know, there's still quite a lot of like up and down. Or at least maybe like. I don't know, a couple hundred feet, but there are walkways that cross up above you. I think immediately as soon as you get off, you notice there are a lot more people here than there were in the upper city. In the upper city, you saw more vehicles, but down here, there's just like a pack of people around you as soon as you get off the elevator. Imagine like, the market parts of Blade Runner, like really crushed in like space, lots of languages being spoken all at once. And I think you walk out into a concourse and there's like a cantina off in the distance and several shops. And there's really no day night cycle down here. It just goes all the time. So when you step off the lift, I think that a couple of like a group of kids like run over to you. One of them, they're all speaking. some of them are aliens. Some of them are human, and they're all kind of like chattering at you. And one of them has a little, I guess like a basket or something, like a plastic basket full of data chips. Data chips. And they're trying to sell you. He's like maps of the middle city, and like pushing it at you. And they all kind of crowd around you.
And you see me just kind of like get a little uneasy at all these like children around me, even though I'm like, oh gosh, what do I do? And then I sort of look down at the data chips and I grab one and then reach in my pocket and pull out a credit form.
Okay. Yeah. So you pay the kid
and then I like shove my way past them uncomfortably, sure that I don't feel like any little pickpocketing fingers and stuff.
Yeah, and you see the kids run over to a guy you didn't notice before who's standing with a force pike, like leaned up against the building. They run over and he takes the credit chip from them and he looks at you. He's got like a mask on. He kind of like looks over his mask, like makes eye contact with you.
Give him a wink.
Yeah, he just kind of nods to you.
And then I guess I take a look at the map.
Okay, yeah, you can just slot it in your...
What was I specifically coming down here for? I forgot. Theron, you told me to come down here for a reason.
Yeah, see if you can discover anything about the rebels and where they may be at. Just any information at all, because we still know nothing about them. Yeah. And we're here to find out something, so we gotta find out something.
Yeah, okay. So at least now I have a map, I guess, of this middle city. But then perhaps I notice that the kids took the money back to him, and I like call one of them back over.
Okay.
And as they come over, I get down I crouch down and I say, "How well do you know this place?"
And the kid says, "It's like I've lived here all my life. I know where everything is. What do you want? Do you want to drink? Do you want to play Sabacc? I can take you anywhere you want to go." And he, like grabs your hand.
And I sort of like, as he like goes to walk away, I like make sure that he can't move. Like my grip tightens on his hand. And I say, "Well, I have enough money that if you can get me information." He's like, "I'm looking for someone."
And he shakes his head. He's like, who are you looking for?"
I said, and I'm like, "I'm looking for a friend. You might know them." And do the rebels? This is a stupid question. I'm not a Star Wars nerdy, but do they have like a specific thing that would be recognizable? Like would they be wearing something that like you likely be recognizable?
Yeah, so there's the symbol of the Alliance to Restore the Republic, which is the kind of red pointy trefoil thing. That's still used as a symbol of like the struggle against the Empire. So it's sort of a war flag for the Alliance. It's getting phased out in replacement of the there's like a more swan shaped thing, the like symbol of the New Republic.
Yeah.
So they use them a little bit differently, but for most people they're interchangeable. The Rebel Alliance and the New Republic are the same thing. You've definitely seen it on graffiti. That'd be the easiest thing to just look around, but the graffiti might not like point you in a particular
direction. That's what I was going to ask though. I was going to ask, is there any posters or anything
Definitely. Like... Yeah. Okay.
So I turn to the nearest poster that I see that's clearly Rebel propaganda. And I said, I'm looking for someone that would be wearing that.
There's a stencil of Emperor Palpatine looking like comically like old and like melted. Like he's all like hideous and scary. You know, like how old World War II propaganda depicting like Hitler and stuff. Where he's all like his arms are super long and creepy, and he's got like strings hanging from his fingers, and there's like little Imperial officers like hanging on them, and then spray painted over it in blue, it says, "The old man is dead. Long live the Republic," and then there's the spray of the Republic logo.
Yeah, so I point to the logo and I say, I'm looking for someone that would have that. I need to give them information.
Okay, let's see. So you just want to ask. Make a charm roll. Let's see if you can charm this kid into just telling you.
Okay, let's see if I can charm. I'm not very charming.
If you want to pay him, I'll give you a boost die if you're like, oh, maybe.
Oh, okay. Oh, what would my difficulty be? I didn't.
The difficulty is going to be 3. Three purple dice.
Okay, yeah, I'm gonna pay him. Which one's the boost?
The blue one.
Blue. Okay. Oh, this is gonna be great.
Believe in yourself.
Yeah, believe. Believe in that stress. You didn't fail. You just stressed, right?
Him more.
So here's the thing. He shakes his head and he says, "Oh, that doesn't mean anything. That's just crazy talk. Listen, pretty lady like you, you don't want to worry about that. Let me take you somewhere fun. You can get a drink, listen to some good music." And he's like kind of pulling you along. And I think as he does this, you look back and you notice that the guy with the pike is now talking to a like an alien, and they both kind of like keep looking at you, and like the guy nods. And I think that you get this feeling now that you realize you're kind of in unfamiliar territory, surrounded by potentially like enemies. And now you're asking about the rebellion, and I think it strains you a little. You feel a little stressed out. So take the 2 strain.
Okay.
And and the kid either doesn't know or isn't willing to tell you. And he's like, "No, come to the cantina. Come on. And like pulling you.
And since I'm getting a little stressed out because I'm like, oh, these guys are going to come after me, I decide, I let go of the kid's hand and I like ruffle his hair and I'm like, okay, lead me to the cantina.
Okay. All right.
I go in or I follow him.
Okay. So yeah, the two of you leave, and I think you don't see this, but the guy with the pike like looks at a group of like obvious like, I don't know, thieves or whatever, and are like, yeah, follow her. And they head out into the crowd to follow after you.
And I would probably notice them because my history has been a part of, like, I would notice the kind of shady people they were because my history has been a part of.
Yeah. 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 Do you want to make a, I mean, you sound like you're on guard. Why don't we have you make a perception check to see if you notice these specific guys following you.
Good luck.
I know. What's my strain and stuff? Or my difficulty?
Difficulty's 2. Throw 2 purple in there. I'm gonna use a dark side point though. So 2 purple, but put one upgrade.
Okay. Is that a red? Oh, 1 upgrade.
Upgrade 1 and put it on the right hand side.
You really want me to fail? Rude.
I just, you know, I like my sneaky guys following you. Yeah. So take 2 more strains.
So stressful.
Yeah. You're just like, you look around and maybe you see like there's threats everywhere. There's like, you know, like anyone could be somebody who's gonna knife you in an alley. Like it's you're in a bad place. So yeah, take that strain, and you don't spot anyone specifically like following.
And maybe I'm stressed also because I don't want to run into someone from my past. That might be a because that's probably possible in this area. So I basically like hurry the kid along pretty much as we're going. I'm like, you need to go faster.
and he nods and he's like, ah, the lady's very thirsty. Yes, of course. Come on. And he like pulls you and like dashes off into the crowd, and you follow him towards this cantina. I think, yeah, before we cut to Otto, we see you walk under a stone archway into a building, and there's this big neon sign like flashing and buzzing, but it's written in an obvious like alien language, so you don't you don't recognize it, but it's like blinking and buzzing as you go in, and then we wipe over to Otto. So Otto, you took some stormtroopers, and where did you go?
So the factory's in the south.
Okay. All right. Yeah. So, I guess, are you flying the shuttle yourself, or do you have one of the stormtroopers do it?
One of the stormtroopers does it.
Okay. All right. Yeah. So, Assistant Chamra tells you like these are the factories that they're going to be surveying. It takes you a little while to get there, but it's still nighttime when you arrive, unless you intend to arrive at a different time.
I want like dead at night.
Perfect. Okay. So you arrive, and we wipe to the shuttle landing amidst obvious kind of factory space. Lots of antennas, and maybe there's like a chimney with smoke pouring up out of it into the atmosphere. Lots of like big industrial droids moving around and moving equipment. When you get there, you don't give anybody any warning you're going to show up, hey?
No. And I'm looking to do more we're gonna land on like a hillside and then walk in, rather than we're gonna land right in front of the factory and walk in.
Okay, so you're landing just like on top of a flat building nearby.
Yeah, I guess there's no land. Yeah, on top of a flat building, and then we're walking in.
Okay, so I think as you land, you know, there's the like steam coming out from the bottom of the shuttle, and you start to walk out. One of the stormtroopers, 882, turns to you and he's like, "Sir, what's the mission here?"
I look through the macro binoculars just down the road, and then I turn and say, "To watch."
And he just nods.
In fact, why don't you just stay here? I'll be back. Then I just start like walking down the road.
Sure. Okay. Yeah. So they stay by the little interplanetary shuttle, and you want to head towards the factory.
Yeah, and I start like looking for, like I would assume that if the governor of the Mon is here, is it Mon or Moth?
Moth.
The Moth.
M-O-F-F.
The Moth, sorry.
It's essentially a governor.
It's a governor, yeah.
Governor.
But if the Moth is here, he has some sort of recognizable transport to bring him to this factory. That's what Otto thinks, at least. And so that's what he's kind of on the look for, or I'm on the look for as I'm walking down the street.
Yeah.
And I'm also just making sure that, like, if someone notices me from like a building to my left or something, and they continue staring at me, that I just make sure that that's in my mind and taking it all in as I'm going down the street towards these factories.
Okay. Sure. Why don't you make a perception test?
All right. What's the challenge? 2?
Yeah. 2 in this case.
Okay. Perception skills. All right. Success.
There you go. You got a success. Okay. So this area isn't populated. It's an industrial area. So there's a lot less of the sort of human detritus. You don't see graffiti as much. It's mostly like there's just mostly like droids around. You don't actually see a lot of humans in general. I think that you do, after a little while of like, you know, moving through the streets and kind of looking around the area, there is a landing pad. You spot it from a ways away. There's an officially looking landing pad, and it does have like the Imperial banners. And sitting on it is a fairly nice looking interplanetary shuttle sitting on the dock. And there's no question for you that this is the Moff's like personal shuttle.
Okay. Are there people around it?
No, it's this whole area is pretty clear. Like where he's staying, it's hard to say.
Okay. Is there some sort of crew that manages that landing pad?
Yeah, it would be, it'd be run by probably like a foreman, but managed by droids mostly. So if you want to find like a maintenance droid or something.
Yeah, I walk over there and look for a maintenance droid.
Okay, sure.
And if I find
there's go ahead. Yeah, there's a droid. There's a droid at one of the like terminals operating it.
Okay. I walk up to it and say, "Droid, where did the people go from this shuttle?"
Yeah, it starts and like turns around. And it's like, yeah, it says, I'm sorry, sir.
The people that exited this shuttle right here, where did they go?
He's like, I'm not authorized to give you that information, sir. If you'd like to speak to the foreman, he'll be returning in the morning.
I try to think back to the times that Theron's made that statement to the droid. Even though, like, he's done it before, I wasn't there earlier. But I'm just like, fuck. Like, I just don't remember it at all. And I just say something really stupid like, the sun only rises twice a day. Just stare at the droid.
Yeah, right. The secret code word.
Yeah. And just fumble it completely, probably.
Well, let's have you make a coercion roll. Okay.
I didn't even know if you would let me make the roll or not.
I mean, I'll let you make the roll to coerce the droid, sure.
Okay. I want him to be like, password accepted.
Yeah.
It's going to be difficulty, I think difficulty 3. Okay. Probably for this.
I'm going to use a light side point.
Okay, sure.
And then does that automatically add it into the roll?
You have to just add the upgrade on the left side. So it should say upgrade 1.
Gotcha. And this is coercion?
Yeah. Yeah, it's coercion.
Fuck.
Do it.
Okay. So you're like, yeah, the sun only rises twice a day. And he's like, well, I mean, on some systems, sir, would you like to know more about binary planets? How can I assist you?
Is there an actual person of some sort here?
No, it's like, it's the night shift, so it's all just droids.
If I look around, like, what are the buildings around? Just a billion type of buildings?
Big, heavy-looking, like, factory equipment. There's, like, like a conveyor belt between some of them moving parts. It's a manufactory. There's lots of stuff getting built in.
Okay, I guess I just walk to a building, any building that's near. Like, walk in, I want to try to find a person.
Okay, sure. You just, like, walk into one of the factories, and...
Oh, I didn't use the upgrade, but whatever. It was still a filled roll, I think.
Okay, here, I'll refund you your light side point.
Yeah, because I used the boost, but the boost had nothing on it.
Yeah.
Oh, well. What do I walk into building-wise?
Yeah, so you come in and there's probably a couple of humans here manning a console. So they're wearing like overalls and the goggles. And down inside, they're like working like a smelter. So there's like liquid metal being poured into molds before it's stamped and then moved outside. And so you walk in, I think one of them notices you, and he turns around. And he's like, kind of squints, like, what are you doing here? It's the middle of the night. Like, he doesn't recognize you.
I walk over to him and say, have you seen the moth?
Like, looks around. He's like, who are you? And he like pats the woman next to him, and she turns around, and she's like, this is private property. You can't just come walking in here. What? Who are you?
I'm late for the rebel meeting.
Takes her goggles off.
Yeah,
I'm
late for the rebel meeting. Rebel meeting.
They kind of look at each other and they're like, "What is this, a joke? Look, we have work to do."
Please don't kill these people. Yeah,
I kind of like look to it. I'm like, how much are? I'm just like in my mind. I'm just like, how much are these lives worth? I really want to kill these people. God, these people are pissing me off so bad. And then I just kind of like, never mind. And then I just like walk out.
Okay.
And I guess I like repeat this process multiple times in multiple buildings.
You're just gonna walk around looking for someone who knows where the mafia is.
Yeah. Hey, anyone know where the rebel meeting is?
Yeah. Oh, you got a rebel meeting.
I start with the moth question and then follow up with the rebel meeting question until something either bad or good happens.
So here's what you can do.
You're muted, Sam.
You can either make a very difficult roll, or you can just spend a destiny point to have me give you like a thing to be like.
Oh yeah.
Oh, you
no,
see,
I'm using a destiny point.
Spend a destiny point. Okay. All right, so I think that you come out, of the factory, and you start walking and like looking around, and you spot some people. There's like three or four of them. They're ducking into an alley, and looking kind of shady. They like are like looking around. You see the last one. He like looks around, and the rest of them like rush into this alley. They all have like workers' clothes on, like coveralls, like muddy coveralls and stuff. But they're wearing like bandanas to cover their face. And one of them has like a big satchel that like rattles as they like duck around this corner.
Okay. Well, let's take a break there. Then I'll pursue after the break. So. Sure. Third and final break here of the show. We'll come back and see if I can get myself killed by the rebels in some shitty alleyway after this. So we'll be right back. Don't go anywhere. More Balance of Power coming up. We'll see you then.